Of some of you have already some experience in Vulcan firefighting bases. For those, I would like to excuse me myself very, very much because I have to start at a very low level. Because most of the of you guys listening to this won't have any kind of Vulcan fire experience, as far as I know. First thing is, sorry for my English. I try to do my very best. We will see. If you can't understand me, just say stop, and I try to explain it in a different way. Beside being a professional chief fire officer, I'm the founder and a member and chairman of AdFire, which is an NGO, which is not a normal fire service in Germany, which is like a non-profit organization. We specialize in vital firefighting and urban search and rescue. We are trained on international standards. We meanwhile have 300 volunteers, volunteer members in Germany, Austria, Swiss, Italy, and the USA. What we do is training. We do controlled burns like this in the hearts. We have international deployments for urban search and rescue and wildfires. Our main influence in the German fire service is which is a very big and large ship, 16 bulk rooms, means 60 states, 11,000 containers, 11,000 captains, means we have 11,000 communities, which is very, very difficult to steer. If you take a European perspective, this ship is much larger. The only thing we can do is to try to make it a little bit better and to turn it a little bit into the right direction. Okay, here we go. Anatomy of a Vulcan fire. Again, it's a very shortcut. This whole thing is very more complex, as you might think. In general, we have the anatomy of fires. We have ground fires or even underground fires like swamp fires. Then you have elevated fire, main due to ladder fuels, which brings the fire from the ground to the aerial, to the crones. And then you have aerial fire, active and passive croning, means that the fire just jumps from tree to tree, followed by a ground fire. Again, this is very rough, but this is what you can see in different kinds of wildfires. I think if you're talking about simulations, you must know this, the main parts of a Vulcan fire. You have the fire head, because the wind drives normally the wildfire. Then you have a head over here with a left shoulder and right shoulder. You might have some spot fires from flying embers. You have a left flank, you have a right flank in the wind direction. You have a heel. You have maybe some islands of unburned stuff in the middle of the fire. You have here a pocket and a finger if there's different kinds of vegetations. And generally, this is the green and this is the black. Also, this green is not ever already green, sometimes yellow or whatever, but this is mostly always the black. Means this is the burned part of the vegetation and this is the unburned part of the vegetation. There are different fire progression speeds within a fire. Normally the front, the head, has a very high speed, the flanks a medium speed, and at the heels you have a very low progression. This is undoubtedly a ground fire. Any hints or ideas on which part of the fire we are? Are we at the head, the flanks, or at the heel? This is not a test, but... Heel, yeah, you're correct. Because you're standing here, the wind blows away from you, and you're not standing in the smoke, which is a good thing, so you're at the heel. And the next thing, if you're standing here, you are standing before the front, because you can see the flames, you're standing in the smoke. That's, from a firefighter perspective, point of view, not that good. But if you stand here, you know, oh, there's the fire front is coming. The point is, this is asked very, very often, why can't humans stop wildfires? normally we can do stop wildfires, but there are some wildfires who can't be stopped. You can't stop a tsunami by putting sandbags at the coast. And the same applies to special wildfires. If there's a special extreme fire behavior with high winds and a special vegetation and a special heat, some wildfires can't be stopped. They just can be, they run along and you have to find a window of possibility where to stop them. But due to very long flames, due to thermal radiation, to spot fires, and even the smoke is heating the fuels, you have a very, very high fire progression, which you can't fight. Even you can't use fly, you can't use planes because no pilot with a sound mind would fly into this dark smoke column, most of them. If you're talking about fire and what influences, how it be influenced, you have three main points. This is vegetation, what kind of fuel you have, what is the fuel temperature, the fuel moisture. Then you have the weather, mostly the wind, and also air humidity, air temperature, and the sun. And then the topography with slope and slope aspect. The slope can also be very dangerous because a fire running upslope is always very dangerous, especially for the guys who are standing here, because they might have not a chance to fight the fire because they can't reach the seat of the flames. So again, fighting fire in a mountainous topography is very dangerous. Internationally is this rule of 30, which is an indicator for maybe coming extreme fire behavior. So 30 degrees Celsius air temperature, 30 kilometers per hour wind, and 30 degree air humidity is a proper sign for that's going to be a really bad day if you have a wildfire or for those wildfires going to come. Just a short look out on wild and fire suppression tools. At first, we have wild and fire hand crews, which are just specialized firefighters. They are not standardized, the teams. They are coming from 6 to 50. They are a little bit standardized in the US and Canada and Australia. But Southern Europe is totally different. They have different kind of hand crews and they even name it different. They can do a direct and indirect fire attack. I will explain this later. They are in combination with a helicopter. They are called helitech crews, means that you have a helicopter with six guys in it or six to eight guys. Depends on the helicopter. The helicopter flies directly to the fire scene, drops the crew off, and they start to fight fire and to coordinate the water drops. And the helicopter mounts a bucket and then gets water and throws water on the fire. This is a very common tactic, especially in Southern Europe, in Spain, where they use this for initial attack. So as far as I know that in Spain, for example, that within 15 minutes at every point in the country, there has to be a helitech crew on scene to fight the fires as long as they are small. The whole thing is not a new idea. I found this one from 1941. In Germany, this is a training manual for hand crews, for fire crews. So it's not only American, it's not only new. It's again, before there were fire engines or helicopters, our ancestors had to fight fire without this stuff. So they triggered something off. But in fire engines, well, they seem to be very different. But if you look from a further perspective, they are generally much the same. They are more same things than dividing things. You can group them very roughly in three groups, in those small first attack trucks. Then the normal wild and firefighting truck like this one is very common. Then you have tankers with much more water. The point is, if you have such a large tanker, it can't go anywhere in the forest anymore because we have 24 tons and you can drive anywhere, even if there's a swamp. Well, we have Spain, we have Poland, we have Australia. Germany is special because they have not really specialized wildfire trucks. They have very, very large numbers of fire trucks, but mostly, and that's a big problem, they are not good for fighting forest fires. So that's a big discussion in Germany right now, if we should have more specialized fire trucks, but that's a German thing. Walter fire operations is another different thing. And from a German perspective, I could say that there's training for pilots is missing, that a lot of air operations tactics is missing, and that even for ICS, for implementing the air operations into the incident command system, we also have also great problems. So, and finally, this is what the result is. This is, I think it's a CH-53 dropping water from 500 meters height because of exploding ordnances on the ground. We all can imagine that this water will evaporate and never hit the ground. Very common in Europe is the single engine air tanker with maybe a dromedar or an air tractor, which are also very good for first attack and for supporting a fire attack. Most will know this one, Super Scoop or the Canadair, which are also in large numbers throughout Europe and Canada, not USA, but mostly Canada, which can scoop more water, but also therefore need a little bit of a large sea or a river where they can take this water. The point about all these helicopters and planes is speed and height, where they can release the water. You can see you can fly very low, and with a high speed you have this pattern. If you fly very high and with low speed, you have this kind of pattern. This takes some experience or maybe an equivalent of training to see how, in which height, with which speed I should drop those water or whatsoever. And even talking about tactics, there's also, speaking for Germany, a big difficulty about implementing air ops tactics in normal fire attack. The French guys and the Spanish guys, and even especially the US guys, are much more experienced and trained in to do this. We are just at the very start and beginning to put up some regulations and tactics to work this. I hope you can understand this, my little graphics here. This is the fire with the head and the heel. These are anchor points. An anchor point is the point where you cut the fire line, and where you secure the fire line, and where you start your attack down the flanks, up and down. Here, the heel of the fire is attacked by fire engines. The flanks of the fire is attacked by hand crews and also by hose lines. The air operations are trying to stop the fire at the flanks, so extinguish the fire at the flanks, and even cutting the head, water drops. You can't normally not put water here because there's too much smoke and that's too dangerous for the planes and helicopters. So they have to work slowly and carefully from the side to the middle. Another kind of tactics, if you're using planes and you're using retardant, I don't know if you know the term, is kind of thickened and colored water, which don't evaporate too fast and stays on the ground for a little longer. You can make those fire lines with it to support special fire lines, like this one. An airplane is used to put a fire line with retardant, while here is a helicopter used to directly attack the fire. So you have a large toolbox. Also, not only for air operations, which has to be trained and brought into service. Problem is sometimes, or that's especially in Germany where we're working at, is that you have tried to implement, to include, to integrate air operations into overall fire operations, which is not always very, very easy, especially if those firefighters don't know how, and that's the case in Germany. For French guys or Spanish guys, this is easy. They do it every day. Let's say for Middle and Northern Europe guys, this is more problematic to implement, to integrate those operations in their fire operations. Wildfire tactics, in generally, the point is, for me being, I've been my whole life a structural firefighter, means I've going out for building fires, But the point is, a building fire is stationary. It don't run away. Maybe the whole building burns to the ground if you're not that good. But that is already the worst case. But if you have a Walton fire, which is very mobile, it won't stop. It won't stop just at the at a large sea or at an ocean. But if you are not as mobile as the Walton fire, you will lose every time. These are our priorities. The first one is protect human life, because normally those forest guys don't like to hear that very well, but it's just a tree and brushes what they're burning. Trees and brushes, and they're not more valuable than human life in average. So the first priority normally for me, being a fire officer at a fire scene, is to protect my firefighters, is to have the safety for the firefighters, to regard this, to take care of them. Then, after this first priorities, all the other priorities came into point. That, like, protect animal life, protect property, and the fourth priority is protect fire spread. And then we're talking about extinguish fire. But these are my first four priorities on a fire scene. We have two kind of things we can do in general, very roughly. We have direct fire intake, where we put water on the fire. And you can see in this picture also one of the first problems: if your hose stream is not long enough to reach the seat of the fire against the wind, you don't do anything with the fire. You will just lose. The other one is an indirect fire attack, where you create fire breaks and all that have different names, fire breaks to stop a fire. The fire runs over here and then it stops because it's just mineral soil, and that's it. You just stop the fire. The main point is not only to extinguish a fire. The main point is to contain a fire, to make it stop, not necessarily to extinguish it. Extinguishing a fire could take days and weeks, because especially if you have a swamp fire and so ever, but containing a fire can be done much faster. This is this is our normal tactic scheme what we have. We start with an anchor point, then we roll up the flanks, attack the front, and then finally we extinguish the perimeter. If you have the perimeter extinguished, let's say 3 to 3 meters, inside here, it can still be smoldering, because you secured all the perimeter. It can smolder in the next 4 days here. It's no problem. As long as you secure the perimeter, everything is fine. Again, here, talking about safety, this is the minimum range of your fire attack, because if your hose stream is shorter than this, the flames will come down and burn you, and you have no effect on the fire. So one of the main measures for our fire attack, for our methods of fire attack, is the flame length. Now, if you have a very small flame like this one, you can use these fire spotters. It's no problem, because the steel of the tool is longer than the flames, so you're not endangered. Means if the fire is as high as a person, you can use this tactics direct. The other tactic, or indirect, and using this every kind of tools. If you're going up, if you have a fire which is in the height of a fire truck, the uses of this tool starts to become dangerous, because if there's a small blow of wind, the flame will go to the ground and will hit this firefighter. So if the flame's getting longer, some things like this, like the fire sweater or a knapsack, shouldn't be used anymore. Then we go with hose lines and fire trucks and so on. And so on goes. If you have flames high like a building, then it's not possible to attack them directly with, let's say, with a small hose line. And you should have more stuff. If you have flames which are very, very high, you mostly have only defensive tactics. Indirect tactics to make fire lines, fire breaks, and to throw retardants and make those fire breaks larger and safer. And generally, this is for our safety, an acronym that they use very often. The US guys use them very often. To have a lookout means that you have one guy who's doing nothing more than just observing this fire scene and see if it develops dangerous fire behavior. Then we always start to attack a fire with an anchor point, with an anchor. Then it's always essentially to have communications to can that you can talk with everybody on the scene. So if everybody sees something dangerous arises, that you can warn everybody else. Then you should have an escape route where you can escape of extreme fire behavior very safely. And this escape route should lead to a safety zone where you can come together and in the worst of all cases, you will be burned over. That means that the fire front will pass as your safe place, but you can still be, you could still survive the whole thing. I tried. Sorry for that, but I only tried. This is not complete. To show the toolbox we have at Walton Firefightings, we have direct attack, we have indirect attack, and we have a combination. To be honest, the combination of direct and indirect attack will be used in the most cases as larger fires. Because if you have a really large fire, then you have different situations on the flanks and the front where you can use different tactics. So this is in general what we have as our toolbox. In a fire, we have water, all kinds of water usage with engines, hose line, and knapsacks. We can use tactical fire, but you need very good trained personnel to do so. Then you have air operations with the direct attack with water drops and indirect attack with the retardant drops. You can also indirect attack with water, but it's not that effective. Then you have indirect attack where we use control lines, where you make fire breaks with hand tools, machines, and retardant lines. You give some addition to those fire breaks with burnout, which means that you burn out the vegetation between the fire, which comes to your position, and your fire break. You can also put retardant lines. You have to take care of spot fires with hand crews or water drops. And what if you have a lot of water, you can do defensive water lines. So this is just an example for firefighting tactics. If we have here a large fire with a few spot fires with a fire head, and let's say we have initial attack here with air operations with one or two helicopters or one or two planes, this is what they normally would do, try to put out parts of the flanks to stop it there, or if you have retardant to slow the fire down so that the ground crews can take care of it. I forget to mention, air operations never kill a fire. They just suppress a fire. It means they make it smaller so that the ground crews can go in there and finally extinguish it. So what you can do, you can send hand crews over here, start working on the flanks. You can send fire trucks here, start an anchor point and working down the flanks. You can use the street over here to do a retardant fire break. And in the end, you can also do fire breaks with dozers. You can work down this flank with a helicopter. So this is, you can use the wildfire toolbox in many, many cases, many, many combinations. There are very few fires where you use just one technique to put fire out. It will be also a combination of different fires.